Well, thanks for having me and for coming. It seems like it's a nice day out despite the cold temperature, but it's nice and sunny and clear, which is always nice. So as Deepthi mentioned, I'm a professor at Yale. I've been there for about 2 years. And my lab is called the Grab Lab, mostly because I do things related to hands, robotic hands, and there's lots of applications in prosthetics and other sort of things. And it is an acronym, but it's mostly Grab Lab. And so in my lab, we have about 20 people. So the work that I'm telling you about today is really the product of more than just my own efforts. We have about five postdocs, six undergrad students, and seven or eight PhD students. So it's a nice crowd of about 20. Okay, so let me just start off also by saying that I'm going to focus kind of the talk today mostly on giving you some background as to the state of the art in robotics, why some of the research that I do is solving an important and difficult problem, and then really only talking for a little bit about some of my own specific research results, because it's important to kind of understand where we're coming from and what kind of problems we're trying to solve and why we need to solve those. So. Let me just, and I'm going to be pretty interactive here, so I'm going to ask you guys a few questions and have you respond, and hopefully you'll be active in doing so. So let me just pose the question of, if you had a robot that you could have it do something for you, what would you want it to do?
Laundry.
All right, that's a good one.
Clean the house.
Writing papers. All right.
Shovel the snow.
Yep. That's a good one. Others?
Go to work for you.
Yeah. You probably get bored with that after a while, though, right?
No? Work.
Drive you to work or fly you to work? Yeah, that could be neat. All right. Yeah, there's all kinds of great things, right? And often, you know, we think about, you know, Hollywood's portrayal of robotics, and we all know Rosie, at least those of us who are over 10 years old or something, probably. Do they still show Jetsons reruns? Do you know the Jetsons? You don't know the Jetsons? Oh, man. All right. Well, anyways, I guess now we you know, 3D animation and things like that are taking over. But we all love Wall-E, right? Wall-E, the lovable trash-collecting robot. C-3PO and R2-D2. You know C-3PO and R2-D2, right? Yeah. Okay, good. And Iron Man, you know, one of the more modern things with the robotic suit that makes... Robert Downey Jr. into a superhuman. Anyway, so unfortunately, we really have a long way to go to practically implement robots to do this sort of thing. So I just kind of want to start off basically to kind of show you where the state of the art in robotics really is. And before I do that, let me just say that in the robotics community, we say that robots are really applicable or going to be practically useful for the three Ds. Tasks that are dirty, dull, or dangerous, right? And most of what you guys told me here fits in with that. All the flying to work is probably dangerous, but neither dull, and depends on how good of a good you are at flying, might not be dirty either. Okay, so what can robots actually do, right? Forget about Rosie and R2-D2 and even Wall-E and that sort of thing. I guess R2-D2 is kind of simple. But so this is an example of a robot assembly line. So robotics are really used very, very commonly in manufacturing. That's the prime application for robotics. And they've been doing this very reliably for 20, 30 years now. Maybe even a little longer for certain applications. So this is a rover assembly line, like a Land Rover, and each of those little orange arms is an independent robot arm that is programmed to do a single task repetitively. So one of them might be welding a seam, one of them might be inserting a panel onto the frame. So each of them do their task, and they do it just in a completely blind way, basically. They're just programmed to do a certain motion at a certain time, and there's no sensing, there's nothing really involved in that. It's just sort of programmed to repeat the same thing over and over again. And that's a very simple task for robots to do, and for things like assembly lines, it's a very useful, reliable thing for robotics to be applied to. Another thing is that we're pretty good at, and it's getting to be almost a solved problem, is navigation and planning. So some of you may be familiar with this DARPA program called the Grand Challenge. They followed it up with what they called the Urban Challenge. But basically, the idea was to take a vehicle and outfit it with a bunch of sensors and computing and autonomously navigate and drive through, I think, about 100 miles of desert road. So the humans couldn't touch it at all. You know, once you hit go, the thing had to do everything automatically. And you'll notice that it was basically it's a software problem. So they added some sensors, they added some computing, but the car, there's nothing special about the car. That's just the outfitted Volkswagen for that winning vehicle. And so it just had to basically sense where the roads were and make sure it stayed on the roads and not drive off into ditches and that sort of thing. And it's not an easy problem, but it actually turned out to work very well. They then moved that on to more city environments with other cars around and things like that, and wasn't quite as easy. But you see some of that technology starting to be implemented already. Some of the new vehicles have automatic parallel parking assists and that sort of thing. I know lots of suburbanites aren't necessarily very good at parallel parking. A funny story, when I was in grad school, in the Boston area, I was walking near the Northeastern campus, and there was hardly anybody around, and I turned this corner, and there's this car with both of its back wheels on the curb. And two high school age blonde girls who were probably driving into the city to look at colleges or something like that were furiously talking on their cell phones, presumably to their parents, asking them what they should do. They saw me coming by, and they were like, hold on. And they were, excuse me, do you know how to parallel park? Because we don't. So they actually gave me their keys, and I parallel parked for them. But anyways, it's difficult, and you know, we can actually get cars to do it fairly reliably for us now. And you'll start to see these sort of technologies implemented more and more. Okay, and bipedal locomotion here, let me just pause this. So this is a picture of Osimo. So most of us, when we think about robots, we think about something that looks like that, right? It's a human shape mostly, walks like a human, talks like a human, that sort of thing. And that's great, not necessarily necessary for a lot of tasks, but the walking part of bipedal locomotion and humanoid robots has been studied for a really long time. It's a pretty hard problem, but walking on level ground, the level ground is fairly even, you can do a repeated task fairly reliably. And so Honda has had this Osimo robot, and there's a number of other humanoid robots who've been able to walk on level ground. Osimo's also even pretty good at walking upstairs. So here's, and he doesn't have to look, right? He's looking at the audience. So there he's walking up the stairs, and oh! I cut the video, but there's like the handlers that come out from behind the curtain with a little screen, and they do there's nothing to see here. You know, the men in black, pay attention to the light thing. Forget all about what you just saw. Sorry? That's probably a lot harder, yeah. I haven't seen a video of that yet. They've actually showed Osimo running, and running is defined by a phase of gait where both feet are off the ground. So there's an aerial phase, and it's like a split-second aerial phase, but it's technically running. So people have been making some good advances here, and that's almost a solved problem. All right, another thing that we're really good at in the robotics domain is teleoperated tasks. So this is where a human sits at a joystick controller-like thing and makes the robot do something by mapping the movements from the controller directly to the robot. So it's basically the human's eyes and brain doing all of the intelligence, and the robot just basically copies the movements that the operator is commanding. So if you've seen the movie Hurt Locker, you'll know about some of the bomb disposal applications for robotics. This is a product by iRobot. There's a few other competing products out there, but a person will stand at a safe distance with a controller and a video camera and cut wires and move things away in order to defuse bombs or dispose of them or whatnot. Another thing that's getting really popular, and you see all kinds of, I think there's a big billboard on 91, if you've seen it, advertising one of the Hartford hospitals. So surgical robotics are really coming into their own. The main product is called the Da Vinci
by a company called Intuitive Surgical. And so the surgeon sits at this little console with a 3D display and these very complicated arms that he is interacting with. And he's controlling the robot that's back in the back of that picture, which is essentially a camera, an endoscopic camera on one arm, and then another two arms have two tools, like little grippers. It depends on the application and what they're doing. But basically, you can do minimally invasive surgical tasks that involve a lot smaller incisions. The robot can give the tools more dexterity than standard laparoscopic tools. So there's usually a faster time to recovery and a smaller incision and that sort of thing, all kinds of things that are very beneficial. And I think even sometimes the surgery itself is more reliable or more likely to be successful because of some of the increased precision. But we're pretty good at the teleoperated tasks there. But what we aren't able to do, and this is really key here, is we're currently, in terms of the field of robotics, unable to physically interact with the human environment autonomously. So if you look around and just think about the types of things you interact with in your everyday life, there's so much variability in terms of shape and color and location and texture, and everything is just so different from it takes babies how many years, right, to figure out how to do even seemingly simple tasks. And it's because they're very difficult to deal with. The manufacturing environment is easy to operate in because the robot sees the same thing over and over and over again. It doesn't need to use very complicated sensing and control and processing and doing it autonomously. So the teleoperated tasks where the human is making the commands directly, the human has all of their sensory and computing to execute that task. So doing these sort of things autonomously is very, very difficult. And when we talk about physical interactions, usually you think about your hands, right? To be able to move something. If you could only just walk around, you'd not be able to accomplish much in your everyday life, right? So being able to actually physically touch and interact with the environment is a very important step in moving robotics forward as a technology. And as I alluded to, part of the reason is because we need better hands for robotics. Okay, so with our own hands, we kind of take them for granted. We can seemingly effortlessly interact and do all kinds of things with them, from very precise tasks like picking up and cracking an egg to power tasks like hammering a nail or so on and so forth. So there's this wide range of functionality that our hands provide us with, and if you really think about it, they're all very complex. And so this kind of raises the question, well, okay, if the human hand works so well, why don't we just copy it? And there we go, we're done. So this makes some sense, and indeed lots of people have tried this approach, and it's really been the dominant approach in the field of robotics. These are just a sampling of different robotic hands that have been developed, and you can see many of them look very similar to a human hand. You would, at least at first glance, think that means they operate like human hands, but that's really not the case. And there's a bunch of reasons for that. You've also seen this, right? So this is ultimately the best prosthesis we could possibly work towards. So Vader cut off Luke's hand, his own son's hand, which is so cruel, but Luke got this state-of-the-art prosthetic hand, which is, of course, just a human hand that they put some special effects on to make it look like it's robotic. So this is a solved problem, some galaxy far away. If we ever get there, we can ask them how they did it. But for now, it's left to people like me and people in my lab to try to figure out how to impart that functionality. Okay. So human hand is simple on the outside, right? We use it every day. We don't have to think about it very often. But let me just try to give you an impression of how complicated the hand is. So this is just a 3D image. Well, it's not in 3D, but somebody made it with some 3D animation software of a hand and arm. So some of the challenges, so the hand has many joints, and therefore it has complex mechanics. So let me just get everybody to think to themselves, how many joints do you think are in your hand?
20.
220? 220? I think that's a little much.
15.
15? Are you guys guessing? Are you counting? Or yeah, so it depends on what you consider a joint. There's on the order of 20 joints. Some of those joints are complicated joints, so they involve more than one degree of freedom. So like your knuckle here, you know, you can flex your finger about it and you can move it this way. There's actually a small degree of freedom that's a roll degree of freedom. So your knuckles are basically 3 degrees of freedom. Each of your fingers is, so if you say 3 here plus 1 and 1, that's 5. So each of your fingers has about 5. Your thumb has about 5 as well. And then there's the whole like palm compliance degrees of freedom. So there's over 20 different degrees, or 30 different degrees of freedom in the hand. You can control 21 independent degrees of freedom in your hand. Now, in terms of joints, that's really more than everything, you know, both of your wrists, both of your arms, both of your legs put together, right? That's the complexity of the hand, not including the feet. So it's really complicated to get all of those movements working in sync and doing something actually useful. You know, babies take a really long time trying to figure that out. So in order to control these many different joints, actuation is a problem. So, I mean, you can imagine trying to create a mechanism that includes that many different joints. It's possible, but it's very challenging, especially in the small space. So actuation, human muscles are about 3 times the power density as the best small motors that are out there. So basically the best actuators you can go out to buy for a given amount of power or efficiency, or you know, any number of measures that you can use for an actuator, are going to be 3 times as heavy or 3 times as big or both. So actually being able to put that kind of actuation that the human muscles have into that kind of a package is really impossible given current state-of-the-art engineering and products that are out there. Another thing is just noise. You know, you don't make any noise when you're moving. Your muscles don't make any noise. But you put a gearhead on a motor, and all of a sudden it's making all kinds of noise and things like that. For prosthetics, this is actually a particularly difficult problem because most people, you know, you think about the hand as being here, right? But pretty much all of the muscles, all the actuators that you use to control your hand are actually in your forearm. So if someone is amputated at the wrist, you don't have that space to put actuators. So you really only have what's in, you know, the space contained within the hand to be able to try to impart that amount of functionality, when from the real hand, it's mostly back here in the forearm. Okay, so let me just think, what do we use every day that you think probably has the most number of motors? What kind of product or thing do you use that has the most actuators?
A plane?
You use a plane every day? Jeez, that's awesome. A car, okay.
Furnace.
Other. So how many actuators do you think are in a car? How many different motors? I mean, it depends on how good your car is, I guess, right? if you were to go out and buy a new standard Honda Accord, which is what I have, how many motors do you think would be in it?
One.
Well, that's an engine, yeah, but you got to put your windows up and down, right? Each of your windows has a separate actuator. You have power locks, windshield wipers. I think for your brakes, you're kind of the actuator. There might be a pump in there that you're controlling. The power steering, right? I don't know. There's probably about 30, maybe more, depending on how much level of detail you want to go into there. You know, if your CD eject is a motor, I'm sure. So that's another one. What do you say? Power seats, yeah. There's all kinds of things. Anyways, so I think for the human hand, it's controlled by 31 independent muscles. It's really comparable to your car in terms of complexity, in terms of actuation, and much more complex in terms of numbers of joints. I think so. All right. So 38 muscles control the hand. Now, those muscles only work in one direction. You know, you can only pull with a muscle. You can't push with a muscle. You know, you can't push on a rope. This is one of the things they teach you in statics in engineering courses. So 38 muscles, 21 controllable joints, even more joints that you can't control independently. There's a complex tendon web in order to route the muscles from back here down to the fingers. It's a really complicated thing that we don't usually think about.
Now, in terms of controlling it, we get in even some more complexity. So this is, if you see that, there's a little diagram of the brain, and the highlighted area there in the middle is the sensory motor cortex. And this is the part of your brain that is responsible for taking in sensing information from the body and using that to control the physical movements of the limbs and things like that. So this diagram here is kind of a cross-section showing which areas of that motor cortex used to control which parts of the body. And this drawing along the outside of that basically shows proportionally how much space is devoted to the different parts of the body. So you have the toes, you know, moving from the left to the right there. You have the toes and the legs, and then you get into wrists and hands and fingers. Then it moves on to things related to the face and tongue and things like that. And so if you were to take and to build a human that was scaled according to the proportion of the motor cortex devoted to different parts of the body, you'd look something like this. You probably wouldn't get very far. Your knuckles would be dragging, I'm sure. You have a great big head and mouth and tongue. But you see how big the hands are? I mean, the hands are bigger. Each hand is bigger than the head, right? So this is how much complexity your brain is involved in the brain in just controlling your hands every day. And then sensors. So, you know, to be able to do the motions, we have to have sensing information that we use in order to plan them and figure out what exactly we're going to do and react. So this is like a cross-sectional diagram of the skin showing a number of different sensors that are involved, and I won't talk about all of them. But basically, there's touch sensors, which is what we think of. There's also temperature sensors, and that's pretty much the types of sensors that would be in the hand. And there's really thousands. I don't know if anybody's ever counted, but I would say on the order of 10,000 or more individual sensors in one hand. And so your brain is basically taking information from all of those and figuring out how to deal with it and then doing something supposedly useful. For robotic hands, you know, maybe the best ones have about 100 sensors. And even with those, aren't really able to do much in terms of being very useful. All right, so the whole point of all of this was basically just to kind of give the impression of how complicated the human hand is and let you know that it's just not easy to copy. And really, with current state-of-the-art technology, we're not able to come even close to copying the hands. Okay, so once you have a hand, what are you going to do with it? So this is just meant to give the impression of the steps involved in carrying out a fairly simple task. So that's a picture of my desk in grad school. It's kind of messy, but in terms of grad school desks, probably not on the lower end of the spectrum there. But if I wanted to program a robot to go and pick up a coffee mug from my desk, what would the steps be involved? Okay. So first, what's a mug? I'm a robot. I don't know what a mug is. I don't have to drink coffee. You know, you have to tell the robot exactly what a mug is, and there's lots of mugs. I mean, each one of you probably has 30 different mugs in their house, maybe. They all look different. You have to sort of decide what defines a mug versus a cup versus a goblet, I don't know, whatever else. Usually it's a little handle, but teacup, mug, what's the difference? Regardless, you still have to tell the robot what a mug is. And once it knows what a mug is and has some sort of a set of rules to decide what a mug is, then it has to go and find the mug or the mugs, usually with vision, computer vision, but maybe with 3D range scanning and other things that are out there. So in this picture, you know, the mug is nice front and center, and you can see the handle of the mug and find it pretty easily. A robot would not find it very easily. Also, imagine if the mug was white against the white computer, right? It would be much harder to find and probably wouldn't even be able to be found with current state-of-the-art in robotic sensing. So let's say you know what a mug is and you figured out where it is in the picture. You have to plan how to get to it, right? So the robot's not at the mug. It can't just reach out and grab the mug. It has to walk over to it. Maybe walk around the desk chair or whatever other junk is on the floor and that sort of thing so it doesn't trip. So it has to plan how to get to it and then move. Moving is not just thinking, right? It's sensing things about the environment, you know, seeing if there's a stair there and not falling over backwards like Asimo did. That sort of thing. So then once you get such that the mug is within your reach, you have to plan where to put the fingers. So, you know, you look at the mug and we all intuitively know to grasp the handle because we've been grasping mugs for our whole lives, or maybe around the side of it, but a robot doesn't necessarily know that. And you can make all kinds of rules and algorithms to try to tell it where it should place its mug, hand on the handle. But even these are not very reliable, and you know, a grasp like this might be a perfectly good grasp, but if you're going to drink from it, you know, you don't want to hold it in that direction. You want to hold it to the side, that sort of thing. So there's all kinds of complicated things related to that. And then putting your fingers there, this is where it really gets complicated. Moving the joints of the robot hand and placing them on the mug without, you know, going too far or not going all the way so you're actually in contact with it. Having enough of the surface area grip so that we have, you know, you have enough friction to be able to hold it and make it so it doesn't slide out. These are all, you know, really complicated things. Then squeeze it with the right force. You know, you don't know how much coffee is in that mug because it's not a glass mug, so it could weigh, you know, 100 grams or a kilogram depending on how big it is and that sort of thing. And you don't want to break it, right? If it's a ceramic. You can't just squeeze with as much force as you can apply. So all of these are, and then lift, right? So lifting it and figuring out how to lift it so it doesn't spill. There's more complicated things here, but I just wanted to give everybody an impression of how complicated that kind of very, very simple task is. And each and every one of these subpoints is not a solved problem in the field of robotics. So it just, you know, kind of shows where we are and where we have to get in order to have these practical devices and what kind of problems we have to deal with as researchers. So the point being is we have quite a ways until we're able to give you guys Rosie or whatever other assistant you might want to fly you to work or whatnot. So, okay. So now I'm going to tell you a little bit about some of the solutions that my research tries to take in order to solve some of these problems. Or approaches. So this was my PhD research. I did my PhD at Harvard. See a little Harvard logo on the wrist there. So this is called the SDM hand. It's called SDM because I made it with a process called shape deposition manufacturing, which I'm not going to talk about much today. But it's a way that you can mold polymers and mold things into complicated components with fairly simple components and tools. So this hand has four fingers. They're arranged like this so that they miss each other, so the fingertips don't actually touch on this hand. Each of those fingers has two different joints, and those joints can move in more than one direction because they're basically little flexures that you can bend in all kinds of different ways. And there's a single actuator here, and I'll show how that's configured in a minute. And there's a little bit of sensors on this one, but I'm actually not using those in anything that I'm showing you for the rest of the talk. So here's a diagram of the fingers. There's stiff links. They're actually clear, so it's kind of hard to see them, but you can kind of see the shadow. So each of these, let me get the pointer. So there's one link, two link, and then the base link here. There's these cream-colored Those have a lot of viscosity in them. So a normal spring, you might pull it back and let it go and it'll bounce around for a while. If you put some damping in it, like on your screen door, it causes it not to oscillate, which is a very beneficial thing. So the material itself has both springiness and damping all inside of it. And actually a lot of our biological materials, skin and muscles and things, have similar types of properties. This one, so the way we mold this, so there's soft finger pads, you know, very like high friction finger pads, so you can get a good grip on things on the grass surface. And then this has a cable that's actually embedded inside this distal link. So all of these is actually molded as one piece. It was a really nifty way of doing things that made the product a lot more durable. So there's a tendon embedded out here, and then it runs through these low friction tubing down to the base where you pull on it. So I would pull on the tendon here. Sorry?
What is the tendon made of?
This is a stainless steel cable. This is probably, Each it's made of about 49 individual strands inside of there. And each strand is probably half the width of a hair. So it's something that's, I don't know, maybe this bundle is about 20 hairs in diameter. And it's pre-stretched in things that has a low bending radius. There's all kinds of, you can just buy it. There's some sensors here. So this sensor is actually a magnetic sensor. There's a rare earth magnet, which is a high-powered magnet. There's lots of toys and stuff out there now using these neodymium magnets. This sensor basically senses the magnetic field. So as the joint flexes, the magnet moves farther away or closer to that sensor, and you're able to tell what the angle is currently. Here, and that's about it. So each of those four of those fingers on the hand. And let me just stop this. Okay. So this is a diagram of how the hand works. So basically the general approach here was to try to, the problem I was trying to solve with my research at this stage was, if you can, so all the other previous approaches that people have done with robot hands was basically to try to copy the human hand structure and then put tons of sensing, tons of processing on a hand, and basically use what we call control to make it all work. So the mechanics were basically not really the point. The point was the sensing and how you control the hand. This approach was basically, and that really doesn't work very well when it comes, especially when down to the stages of making contact with the object. You can imagine if you have a highly geared finger, it's going to be really hard to place that accurately so that you're not applying too much force or not enough force to the object to be able to get a good grasp on it. So a lot of this has to do with trying to find mechanical solutions so that you basically, the mechanics of the hand, did I just lose?
Yeah, the house mic.
Has it been going out?
No, just now.
Is it on? Battery?
It's the house mic.
Okay. I should keep going though, I guess?
Yeah.
Okay, I'll try to talk a little louder. So the mechanics of the hand basically make up for a lot of the challenges in the task not having to rely on sensing and control. And sensors are actually really, really expensive and also very fragile too. So whenever you come and, you know, if you think the object is in one place and it's really somewhere else, you're going to jam the hand up against it or hit the table or that sort of thing. People break their hands all the time. So this was another aspect of this. So pay attention to one finger here. Pay attention to this finger. I'm going to just talk through. So this is kind of a diagram of the finger that I just showed you. So there's a tendon that runs, that's anchored out here, and it runs over basically pulleys to the base. So imagine right where that T is pulling. The way this is structured that makes it work well is that if I pull this tendon and I make contact with an object on this, there's a round object right here. If I make contact there, I can actually keep pulling the tendon, and the outer link is going to keep closing until it makes contact with that object. So there's basically a single actuator that controls two independent degrees of freedom. And this is called under-actuation. It's something that's a fairly under-researched mechanism concept, but it's the same kind of thing that's in your car differential, in your car. So when you're going around the bend, the wheels on your car are actually spinning left side at a different rate than on the right side. And unless you have a differential in your car, you're going to get squeaking and lose traction in your car. And the differential allows those wheels to passively rotate at different speeds without needing to have a motor for each one separately. So that's kind of the same basic idea here, is I can have a single motor on this tendon or on this finger and keep pulling it, and I can make contact with this and still be able to keep closing this outer one until it makes contact. And by designing this so that I have two more stages of pulley, I can pull with a single motor here, and this basically enforces an equal amount of tension on each cable, so I basically can keep pulling that tendon until every single link on the finger has made contact with the object. And I don't need to know anything about that either. I just can pull that tendon until it stops, and I know that all of the fingers have made contact with the object. So it's this very nice adaptive way of being able to grasp a wide range of object shapes and different positions and things like that. Without knowing anything about that object, all I need to do is just keep pulling that tendon until it stops moving. So here's just a... it's a little more complicated there. So what I do, a little more advanced here, we do what's called current control. So we apply a fixed amount of current to the motor, and it will basically keep moving until the motor stalls. And a motor will basically apply a certain amount of current, or a certain amount of torque that's proportional to the current. So basically, it'll just keep spinning until it's applied enough torque that it stalls. So if it's a squishable object, it'll squish to a certain point and then stop moving. So this is just to kind of show the adaptability of the hand. So there's a volleyball. This is about human hand size, so it's a pretty good grip here. And you can just see that we're operating this the same way for each of these objects, for each of those locations. Basically, just keep pulling that tendon until it stops moving, and it just passively adapts to the shape of the object without any sensing at all. It's a pretty neat neat little approach that solves some of those problems in manipulation. Okay, so the way we're building these things, it leads to pretty durable devices. Some of the major problems in previous robot hands, people would build a hand that has a lot of complexity in it and have hundreds or thousands in a single hand. Some of the complicated research hands that people produced back in 20 years ago cost about $100,000. If you wanted to buy one, maybe $150,000 for one hand, and you'd make one false move, and break a finger or multiple fingers. It would cost you $30,000 to fix, 6 months to fix it, who busted it, that sort of thing. We don't exactly have tons of money in academia, so these were really big problems. So having this kind of durability here is very, very useful. You can really bang the heck out of it and it won't break. It's waterproof because of the way we mold these sort of things. So, okay, so this is basically me. Let me talk. Pause this for a second. So this is teleoperated. I'm basically sitting at a desk looking at the robot, and I'm holding a smaller robot, basically, that has kind of a pen attached. It's a little stylus, and there's a little pivot at the tip, and I can move it in 3D. And what I'm doing is basically using that small robot called the Master to basically map the positions of the tip of that pen to the tip of the arm here. So I'm basically, and there's a scaling factor. So I move it 1 inch and it moves 4 inches or something like that. So I'm just looking at this workspace that's on the other side of the table and moving these things and then hitting a button to close the hand whenever I'm ready to grab something. So this is just kind of to show the wide range of different objects, sizes and shapes, weights and stiffnesses and that sort of thing that we can grab. Remember, there's only a single motor here. So with your human hand, with your 38 motors and 21 degrees of freedom, you can obviously do all these things. And indeed, all those objects are built to match your human hand, so you can grasp them easily. So we're able to do a lot of these things with even just a single motor. And no sensing, no control. I mean, it's a very, at least from the hand side of things, the robot has some sensing and control on it, of course. But you can do all sorts of things. This next one here was sort of the crescendo demo. Grasp a full glass of wine on a white tablecloth. I did this a bunch of times. We had a program manager, which are, those are the guys that have all the money for research. We had them through the lab, and I was showing him this demo. I've done it like 20 or 30 times, and I was a bit nervous, and so I spilt the wine for the first time in front of this guy, and of course we didn't get the money, but he wasn't going to give us money. But sorry, didn't build a robot to clean it up yet. But anyways, I mean, that's a very, very difficult task to do. The wine glass is easy to break. You can spill the wine easily, as I showed. I'm about to squeeze the Charmin here. My advisor actually, my PhD advisor, made me delete this from the original video because he thought it was in poor taste, but I kind of liked it. all right. Anyways, so that's kind of the results of my PhD work. I'm doing a lot more work with this, but other people have implemented these my designs on their own robots. I don't think I have battery here anymore. This robot on the left is a robot that was built at MIT called Nexi. You can see a close-up of the hands. Those are basically the fingers that I had designed. We built a version of it for Osimo. They're still not really at the point in research with Osimo where they're ready to deal with the hands, but right now Osimo's hands are just cosmetic. They don't really do anything useful, so they wanted to put more utility in the hands and arms. And there's a robot that also incorporates the finger designs. Okay, so it's pretty clear how some of these approaches might be able to apply to prosthetics. Basically, to kind of give you an idea of where the state of the art is in prosthetics, most, I would say 80% of upper limb amputees use a device that looks like one of these two guys. It's a split hook, so it's kind of two metal prongs that have a single joint, and then there's a rubber band around them to hold them closed. And that little lever that comes out, there's a cable that attaches to that, and the person, I'll show you it in the next slide, the person will move their arm, shoulder, and their elbow in order to get a tension and pull on that cable, and they could open and close the prosthesis. The original patent for this, that's changed very little, was from 1912, I think. It's really not changed much at all since then, almost 100 years, and so many people use it. It's really durable. It's inexpensive. People can do lots and lots of things with it. I would say the biggest advancement in this design came with the cigarette notch after World War II. So they made it because everybody was squishing cigarettes, and so many people smoked back then. So they improved it with a cigarette notch, and I think actually all of them have cigarette notches on them now, basically. That's kind of the major improvement on there. Here's the shoulder harness. So a person would wear this, and there's a cable that's attached to the back of the shoulder that runs over the joints. And that cable is kind of like the bike brake cable, where you pull on the handles and it pulls on the brakes. This way, it would pull on that lever and open and close the prosthesis. So this is really what most people use. And they like it for a number of reasons. It's lightweight, it's inexpensive, it's durable. And if you notice, the whole pulling on the cable thing is basically the same kind of idea for the hands that I did. And so we're working towards a prosthesis that could be used in the same sort of way with that same type of idea. Adding a motor, so there are a number of different powered prostheses that are out there on the market. People don't like them all that much, so they're not used regularly. And the reason why they don't like them is because they're heavier and not really significantly better than the split-hook body-powered devices. But you have at least the option of putting a more cosmetic glove on it to make it look a little bit more realistic. Usually the way it goes is people, once they're recently amputated, will prefer something that looks a little bit more realistic. But there's the trade-off because it usually doesn't work. So people start off, usually because of the psychology involved, wanting something that looks like a hand, but then after they realize that they can do a lot better with something that isn't quite as cosmetic, they'll switch to the split hook type of things. But there are some split hooks that are powered. The wearer will have what's called myoelectric or EMG electrodes on the residual limb, where they flex a muscle and it picks up the electrical activity with that muscle and can open and close the hand from that.
Yeah, can you get into that a little bit more, how that works?
In terms of what?
How does the brain function and how do they know what to operate on? Is it attached to the tendon?
No, it's not attached at all. Basically, there's a lot of research. Thanks. Covert operator here. So there's a lot of research where people are trying to actually attach directly to the nerves and things like that that are there. It's not used in practice, it's still in the research stage. Basically any commercial product just uses these surface electrodes that, you know, there's literally no physical attachment to the body at all. It just rests on the surface of the skin and it can pick up the electrical signals from the muscles from the surface of the skin and then amplify that and use that to control the prosthesis. So, and you can control maybe one or maybe two motors independently that way.
Based on what you said, why do I want Da Vinci to operate on me, since the hand on Da Vinci is not as fine as my own, and since it's being directed by a human anyway, why are you better off with the human doing the job and not worrying about a mechanical breakdown of Da Vinci?
Well, because you can't get your hands into a little small incision. So people do laparoscopic surgery with small tools, but those are basically use a scissor handle. So all you can do with a laparoscopic tool is open and close a cutter or a cauterizer or something like that. Or smaller, yeah. There's a port. The port is probably one incision. Yep. It also has a wrist on the tools. So the laparoscopic tools that they use for minimally invasive surgery that's not robotic is it's just a straight shaft. And so you can only really can operate in the direction of that shaft. So if you need to turn a corner, you're stuck. So with the robotic tools, you can basically put them in one direction and have a full range of motion of that tool in order to get at, you know, at a different angle, that sort of thing. And that helps, you know, because there's certain places to go to make the incision that are better than others, but it might not be as good, you know, to get to a certain organ or something like that you might need to operate on.
I'm sure it works because I know it's been done, but from what you said here, I would have done in the first place saying, whoa, they're not as good as mine.
They're not, but when you put the laparoscopic tools on that they would use otherwise, it goes out the window. It's basically as crude as a wrench or something like that that you would use. So.
But I think most of the more recent data that I don't know about, the data that surgery is better with the Da Vinci, it's not such fantastic data. It's only better with an operator who absolutely knows what they're doing and has done it.
Yeah, there's a lot of complicating factors. Yeah. I think gallbladder surgery, prostate surgery, is I think they've shown that those are better, have better results. And I think it might be FDA approved for a few other surgeries, but they're doing a lot of research now. The kind of holy grail there is being able to do heart surgery without opening up the person's chest because of the trauma induced actually with doing the open heart surgery and things like that. So, and they're really working towards that, but not there yet. So, all right. We're moving in this direction a little bit. This is an image from a magazine called Technology Review. I guess that slide was timed. This is a picture of one of the hands we built in the lab recently. So we're trying to make it a little more anthropomorphic so that we can have sort of the simplicity of successful commercial devices that are durable and that sort of thing, use a single motor, but also be highly functional and hopefully as close to a human hand as possible. Not that this one necessarily does, but we're working on some of those sort of things. Okay, so the last thing I wanted to show is a kind of crazy other project that we're working on in the lab. So because of the properties of these hands, they can be made very lightweight. And so we're doing a project where this is a small helicopter. It's about this big. And we can actually go and physically interact with things from the air. A pretty new thing because all of the all the aerial vehicles that are used in search and rescue and that sort of thing. Defense applications are really just sensing. You know, they're just taking some camera images or that sort of thing and not able to actually do anything useful otherwise. And so, you know, just like putting hands on regular robots, ground-based robots could help things, this could help things as well from the aerial platform perspective. Yeah, there's all kinds of things. We don't think too much about the defense applications, but there's all kinds of things that it could help with, I'm sure. You said something? Okay. Oh, sorry. If you could use this to, in like a war zone or something like that, to pick up a mine or that sort of stuff. Yeah, there's all kinds of things that you could do there. So, and there's all kinds of hard research problems because these aerial platforms are very unstable. If you've ever ridden in a helicopter, you probably feared for your life, and rightfully so. You go to great lengths not to interact with other things that are rigid in the environment, right? With helicopters, you basically punch it to jump off the ground, and you cut the power to it's really hard to control the interaction with the ground, and this kind of thing is, there's all kinds of hard beats. It's easier with bigger helicopters too, because they have a smaller natural, bigger natural frequency. Okay.
Quick question. Yeah, as Dicky mentioned in the beginning about material sciences, is your hand largely in existence because of new materials and evolving technology that you mentioned? Is this new technology that's allowing you to do this?
It's a combination of a number of things. I think the materials are. I could get the same performance, not durability necessarily or ease of manufacturing, but I could get the same performance with standard, you know, aluminum parts that I fabricate, that sort of thing. So it's not helping the mechanical solution, but the fact that I can mold these things all in one part makes them very inexpensive or potentially inexpensive to make. You know, you could just injection mold them or something similar. It also makes them more durable, so all the parts, there aren't screws that can come loose and things like that. You know, you can, I made a previous prototype, each finger had 100 parts, right? Just because of how many different screws and things I had to use in order to attach everything together and that sort of thing. So this is basically one part. It makes it a lot easier that way. We can also iterate the design very quickly, much faster than if we had to build all the parts individually, that sort of thing. I'm a mechanical engineer and decided I wanted to go to grad school and get a PhD and teach, and just kind of found some labs that looked interesting to me, and it sort of just happened in all kinds of different fortuitous ways. So.
And did you actually think those two girls wanted you to pack your car? You fell for the van. That's
what the world made you a lot. Yeah, I don't think it was, but.
Mm-hmm. Normally, the way a normal hand works, we touch with the outside digits and then we close.
It depends. It depends on what you're doing.
What made you think of using the inside digit as the touch area and then closing with the outside?
If the base of the arm is fixed, I think the things that we, the tasks that we would do in the way you're referring to, where we would touch with the distal links first, you actually are rotating your wrist to bring the rest of it into contact. So you're actually moving your arm to put the rest of those links into contact. If the arm is fixed and you make contact out here, there's actually no way of making contact with those inner links first. So it really just depends. You know, if you were to move the arm and then lock it after it's in place and then close the fingers, you would want to contact the ones that are closer to the palm first and then wrap the fingers around it. And you do that with lots of things, just not everything. Um, There are. So, I mean, a memory foam is similar to the joint material that we use. It has some viscosity to it, and it's a slightly different. It's a lot softer, the stuff you're referring to, of course. But, yeah, I mean, the finger materials, the finger pad materials that I use actually have a similar type of effect that help conform to the shape. You know, you have to be able to still apply enough forces to it, so things that are really soft aren't necessarily going to work very well. Well, I mean, for being able to have robots interact with things in the environment, everything in that list of eight things that I talked about are all important and equally as important. You know, a lot of it is related to more computing type problems. A lot of it's more materials. A lot of it's more sensing. There's all kinds of different fields, and of course, you know, I'm not going to be dealing with the computing side of things. I'm a mechanical engineer, so there's lots of, that's one of the interesting things about robotics is it's so interdisciplinary that, you know, I work with computer scientists, psychologists, you know, biomechanists, all kinds of people from different backgrounds, all kind of working towards similar problems, and then they're all equally as important. So
I don't know if I have any major thing there. Computing used to be a big problem.
That's not really the major issue anymore. Sensing is still a big problem. And from my perspective, I work on the mechanics, you know, trying to build mechanical hardware that works well, and that's been a problem too.
I imagine integrating all those tasks that you don't have is probably a really
Next step. Yeah, the people in my lab, you know, we all tend to be kind of like the jack of all trades, master of none type people. That's usually used in a negative connotation, but we have to know a lot about a lot of different things in order to do the stuff that we do. And that appeals to lots of people and doesn't appeal to certain people as well. But you also have to get comfortable with realizing that you can't know everything. So a lot of academics, you know, they're the absolute experts at some very narrow area. In our field, it's kind of the opposite. You know, we have to sort of be willing to just say, I don't know about that. You know, and you know, I have students who know much more about certain areas than I do, and vice versa. So there's all kinds of interesting things that happen there. So.
So if there are no more questions, a round of applause. Thank you very much. PBS would like us to give feedback on just making stuff sponsored with cafe.